Very good morning, my dear students. Today is the plant protection class. So we are going to detailly study about the biological control of pests and diseases. So from the title, you can understand that what we are going to study today. So the pest control can be done by using the several tactics. Should have studied in the integrated pest management. So we are going to use so very different tactics to manage the pest in an integrated way. So one of such tactic is the biological control, right? So biological control, the primary objective is to controlling the pest by using a living organism. It may be the insect, it may be the predator, or it may be the non-insect, it may be the pathogen, anything we are going to use to manage that pest. That's what we call it as a biological control. So from this class, you are going to learn what is biological control and the, what are the benefits of the biological control and the mechanism of the biological control agents to suppress the population of the pest and disease. And requirement for successful biological control. What are the requirements needed to manage these pests and diseases successfully? And the current commercially available or working examples of these biological controls. So these are the sections you are going to study and I am going to cover from this class. So first we will discuss the what is biological control actually means, right? So first, it's coined by the Harris Smith in relation to the biological control of insect. The person, the scientist who defined the biological control, so related to the insect, right? So he mentioned that the suppression of the insect population by native or introduced enemies, suppression, not complete elimination, suppression. He used that term. Suppression of insect population by native or introduced enemies. So he called that one as an insect biological control, right? So for example, if you are taking that the generic, what is mean by the biological control is broadly termed a population leveling process. It's a population leveling process in which the population of the one species lowers the number of another, right? One organism's populations can be leveled, is mean reduced by the other organism's populations. That is, we call it as a biological control, right? So in the why we are using this biological control, what are the advantages of the biological control in comparison to the chemical control? Because we are going to use one against the chemicals. Why? If we are using the chemicals, you cannot use the biological control agent. So it's a contradictory, right? So why we are going to use biological control instead of chemical control? What are the disadvantages and what are the advantages? For example, if you are taking the comparisons, chemical pesticides and biological control agents. So chemical pesticides are cheaper, right? Anytime you can buy, right, in cheaper prices. So at that point, so biological control may be expensive. The initiation of the biological control agents development and the screening are costly. Right? So biological control is a labor intensive, for you need many labors for rearing and feeding and field inoculation and monitoring that pest population and beneficial organism and bioagents population. You need so much of labors. That's labor intensive. So that's the chemical. Once it's developed, you don't need anybody. Nowadays, the drone can spray. One person can use, right? Totally control the pest by using the equipments. Yes, labor intensive is less. So that's it. That means that this is cost effective. That is not cost effective. But biological control are cost specific. Host specific mean for the target pest, you have to use a specific enemy, right? So, but the chemicals are broad spectrum. Some chemicals are broad spectrum, not all the chemicals, but majority of the chemicals are broad spectrum. Some chemicals are having the narrow host range, but not the host specific, right? So that's how this biological controller advantages. So if you are taking the chemical pesticide, this is an implications. So you know that one, the chemicals are nasty, right? It can cause a health hazards to the human being and the biodiversity and other living organisms. So if you think that in this case, so you should choose the biological control agents. It is non-toxic, toxic to human beings, right? Non-toxic to human beings. That means that non-target effect. There is no any non-target effect. So required yearly treatments. I required yearly treatment. So once the crop season starts, every time you have to spray. But instead of the chemical biological control agents, once you inoculate it or release the biological control agents into the field, it automatically replicates and its population will be developed and decline according to the enemy's populations. Right? Enemy's population. This is broad spectrum. So therefore, it can cause both toxic to both beneficial and pathogenic organisms. Even can cause the damages. The chemicals can cause the damages to the and non-pest organisms too. So once it's colonized, it's a host-specific ones mean automatically it will multiply. It can. So these are there is no contaminations to the water or other human being and the household or other living animals. So therefore, the summary it says that biological control agents are self-perpetuating. Self-perpetuating means it will replicate automatically. Once you released it, automatically it will multiply its population according to the enemy's population and pest-specific. For example, if you go to, if you are going to control the yellow stem borer of the paddy, the specific parasitoids that can attack only the yellow stem borer only, you can get it and you can release it. Right? For example, the trichogramma, egg parasitoids. So it can attack the yellow stem borer egg. And a density dependent. For example, if the 1,000 enemies are there, then if you are releasing the 500, according to the density of the enemies, it can automatically multiply its population. If the enemy's population is declining, it also declining its population because there are shortage of food. The cost effective. So I told earlier, I told you this is cost ineffective. Now I am telling that this is cost effective. Why? Cost effective means once you have screened the biological control agent, once you have released into the field, it is cost effective. Automatically, it will multiply. But initial development cost is higher comparison to the chemicals. That's what is I earlier mentioned that cost ineffective. So if you are writing this answer, you have to explain it in which condition. Right? In which condition? And environmentally compatible. This means it will not cause any toxic to the environment. The, what are the constraints of this biological control mean? Non-immediately effect. It's not quick down effect. If you are spraying chemical, pest gone. Bye. But biological control agent, it take time to adapt to the environment. Then again for searching of the prey, again targeting the prey and eating and that, so declining of the pest population slowly will increase. It will take time and years. That's what is non-immediate effect. Non-eradicating. So once it's established in the field, this biological control agents, it is not eradicatable. So you have to use chemicals, again chemical, to eradicate these biological control agents. Because it can fly and go somewhere else. If you are releasing in Sri Lanka, it can go maybe in India. It may be in Pakistan, right? It's border. Beyond the border, it can fly and it can cause an inter-country's problem. For example, if you are releasing something into Sri Lanka, it may be beneficial. If it is going there in India through the border, through the sea and into the, enter the India, then there will be a problem for the biodiversity of the India, right? Biodiversity of the India, for example, in the COVID-19, right? So first, that's what the people are blaming the China, right? So this, if it is a biowar agent, COVID-19, if it is released into China, so people will not worry about that. If it is not informed by the China properly to the other countries, it is spreading. That's what the other countries are claiming. And that's the biological best example where you are studying to compare the COVID-19, right? COVID-19. So this is, you can see, COVID-19 is attacking human being only, not the other bios, the other insect or disease, right? So mainly non-target effect. But some non-target effects are there. For example, the flu virus, bird flu, it can attack human being. It can attack all the live animals, right? Or the farm animal, right? Bird flu, that's something different. Biological control agents are unknown for many pest species. Initial screening is a little bit difficult because you have to screen, it will take several years, 10, 20 years to screen against the pest, to identify the biological control agent, because it's a very small sometimes, it will not work properly. So that's the thing, it will take. Doesn't always work. If it is working in Sri Lanka, it may not work in India, or it may not work in China, or it may work not in America. Why? Because it works certain environmental conditions. It needs some condition. That's what success rate is less. For example, we introduced to manage the papaya mealybug, the Acerophagus papaya. Right? Acerophagus papaya is a parasitoid against Paracoccus marginatus papaya mealybug. This was not success in Sri Lanka. Why? So this parasite, because we imported from this Java island, this parasitoid, right? Paracoccus marginatus. Against Acerophagus papaya, right? Acerophagus papaya. So the why it is not worked? So because of environmental conditions was not suitable. But if you're taking that coconut leaf miner, it was success. Have you heard about that? Primicotica cumingi against the Dimochia javanica. So Dimochia javanica is a wasp introduced against Primicotica cumingi, leaf miner of coconut. It was very successful in Sri Lanka. Now there is no pest, no beneficial organism, because it's very host specific. There is no food. Beneficial organism also died. Both are in the museum. If you are there visiting, they are in the CRI nowadays. So if you are going there in the study tour, I don't know how it is possible. If you are there, CRI, you can see that in the CRI museum, Coconut Research Institute Museum, Ludovilla, you can find it. It will be there somewhere. Right? So these biological control agent types. So there are three different status, the three different categories you can divide the biological control agents. One is inundative or mass release of biological control organism. Second category is the classical introduction of the non-native biological organism. Other one is the conservation or management practices to favorable the. There are three different categories of biological control process. So normally we can start with this conservation. So conservation, we are going to start with the conservation. Again, this classical, again inundated, right? So conservation means, so you all know you are from Puttalam. If you think that you are from Puttalam or if you are from Anuradhapura, so you would have seen that some pests are present in Anuradhapura. So the biological agents for that pest may be present in Anuradhapura. Right? But not in other areas. If you are identifying that is native to that place, you have to conserve it. Otherwise it won't work, you know. Otherwise this will not work in Puttalam, this will not work in Jaffna, this will not work in Mullathivu, it would work and travel because of this climatic condition, and it is native to that place. So there are conservation techniques mean you have to give up protection and allow them to multiply its populations. Right? Once it's developed its population, you can take it and you can release somewhere else for the testing. That is we call it as a conservation. Conservation means so to protect that native beneficial organisms. That is we call it as a conservation. So you have to give them give the proper house habitat. I mean habitat. You have to give the proper habitat and proper food and proper non-spray of unwounded chemicals to that area. So if you identified, right? So in this way, you can conserve that biological control agent. Another one is the inundative mass release of biological control agents. Inundative mass release of biological control agent means I told you are going to conserve it from somewhere else. From that, you can multiply it and you can release it some other part. If now, Mullathivu, Puddalam, or Adnabro, Kenti, or somewhere else, if you want to control the same pest, right, you can release it. That's how we are doing that one. So, inundative release, time to time, multiply artificially and release it. Right, that is inundative. Another one is the classical or introduction of the inundative biological. That's what I explained that the Primicotica cumingi, a parasitoid imported from the Java island. Right? Paracoccus marginis, papaya mealybugs, parasitoid, Acerophagus papayae introduced from the Java island. Why? These pests are also not native to Sri Lanka. This is introduced pest, alien pests. Coconut leaf miner, alien pest. Parthenium nowadays is an alien pest. So this papaya mealybug is an alien pest. So many others, so leaf miner, alien pests, many other pests are nowadays alien pests. To manage the alien pests, we cannot find that biocontrol agent in the native place. Why? If there is no food, no beneficial organisms. This means no food for that one. It's, there is no chances for that beneficial organism. So therefore, you have to go there in the original place where from where this pest introduced into Sri Lanka, you have to pick it. That is we call it as a classical biological control. In these three ways, three different types of biological control methods we are using, right? But nowadays, mainly we are using the classical and the conservations. So mainly we are using for classical and the conservation, so inundative release, so they are for some of the farms. So it's labor intensive to rear the biological control agent, but some of the sugarcane research institute, the coconut research institutes, these institutes are, they have tea research institute, they are developing the specific biocontrol agents related to that their cost. For example, coconut CRI, they are rearing that pest for coconut pest, sugarcane, pairing for sugarcane. These research institutes, they are developing and releasing. But I saw this is we call it as a, there are three different types of biological control. So first, the classical biological control is an introduction of the control agent into a region that is not part of the natural range to suppress permanently the population of selected target pests usually and also introduce that. That's what I told you. Where it's pest originated, you have to introduce that biological control agent to, otherwise, it would, well, that's what we could say, classical biological control. Non-native, we are introducing into the country. So the classical biological control is an exotic insect pest by the introduction of its natural enemies, right? Control of an exotic insect pest by the introduction of its natural enemies. That's what we done in coconut leaf miner and the papaya mealybug. So other than that, for these aquatic weeds also we managed that for the aquatic weeds. So some of the aquatic weeds, I will discuss that. These weeds also, they manage that one. As well, for example, Salvinia. The Salvinia molesta is managed by a weevil. Right? The weevil is introduced from the origin and it worked well now. It is also used to manage that as a classical biological control. For the classical biological control programs, if you want to introduce any biological control agent into the country, it is not easy task. Why? So you have to go for a foreign exploration first. For example, I'm explaining. For example, if you identify a mealybug, for example, I'm taking papaya mealybug. Papaya mealybug, it suddenly came into 2004 something into the Sri Lanka. So it caused significant economic damages to the papaya, orchard industry. All over the Sri Lanka, papaya gone. So because it's sudden outbreak of these mealybugs, no? Then what they have done is they use the chemicals. Because sudden outbreaks, we have to manage it, we have to control it. There is no any biocontrol, other tactics. They sprayed chemicals, it won't work because the mealybugs are excreting these waxes. Through the waxes, chemicals cannot penetrate, it won't work. What the people claim that, so they wanted to bring a biological control agent. So where this pest originated. This is called as a foreign exploration. You have to search it, where that pest originated. So then you have to go there in the originated place. For example, if you are thinking that it is originated from the US. You know, just I'm taking this is because this papaya mealybug is came from India through the fruit importers, right? Foreign exploration. For example, I am taking another example. So Mediterranean fruit fly. Right? If you want to control this Mediterranean fruit fly, the fruit fly problem in Sri Lanka, you have to go there Mediterranean areas. Then you have to search, is there any biological control agents in there in the Mediterranean? Because it is best originated in Mediterranean countries. You have to go all the Mediterranean countries. You have to search day and night and go to field and you have to search, is there any biological control agent? Okay. So once there, if you identified externally, okay, biological control agent is there, then you have to get the permission from that countries to import into the Sri Lanka. Again, Sri Lanka also, the quarantine also have to give a permission to import that biocontrol agent. Then you have to bring it and you have to rear it in the quarantine conditions. In the quarantine, Katunayaka, you have to rear it. And you have to check it again, this papaya mealybug, or if it is works. Then you have to check it, other insect pests, other beneficial organisms, whether it is giving any non-target effect. Right? Non-target effect. You have to check, okay, it is perfect. It is only attacking the papaya mealybug. Then you, through the quarantine process, you have to bring it to your research institute because Department of Agriculture can only introduce. Other universities can introduce only for the research purposes. Right? Department of Agriculture can have the authority to import that. So import. So then they are in the research institute, the Department of Agriculture Research Institute, they will mass propagate it, multiply. And multiply it, then they will release in the field. Field release. You see how long it will take. Field release. Once it's released in the field, then continuously you have to monitor it, whether it is adaptable to this environment. Whether it is working on the pest, right? How much efficient it is working. So all these things we have to check it, that field colonization, evaluation of it is impact, whether it is working or not. Once it's worked, then okay, it is working. But it is working, the multiplication rate is less, then again you have to mass propagate it. Time to time you have to release it. Time to time, you have to release it. That's what I told you. This is we called as an inundative mass release. If it is not adapting to the feed, you have to multiply and time to time, slowly, 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 every 6 months, you have to 1,000, 5,000, 50,000, according to the pest density, you have to release it. That is, we call it as a release strategy, inundative release. Then ecological interaction, long-term assessment. Okay, you are releasing and releasing. Long-term, how long, for the long-term assessment mean, whether the population of this beneficial organism adapted to the environment and multiply and reproductive, or it is not giving a non-target effect in the long term, you have to as a many, maybe more than 5 years, 5 to 10 years, you have to go for a long-term assessment, right? In this way, this classical biological control is very efficient. It is very successful, but not always. 1 in 4, they are success, right? This is a process of the procedures, a rigorous procedure for introduction and monitoring of this classical biological control. Right? So this biological control works in three different categories. So you can divide these natural enemies into predators, parasitoids, and pathogens. Right? These living natural enemies control in predation, parasitism, and disease causing. In this way, they can able to suppress the pest, right? One is predator, parasitoid, and pathogen. So we will discuss one by the predator. So what predator mean? So they can prey and kill and eat. That is, we call it as a predator. It may be insect, it may be the mice, it may be the spiders, or it may be the vertebrate, snakes, scorpions, and snakes, scorpions, and bandicoot, some of these, not bandicoot, some of the anteaters, this is we called dragonflies, this we called as a predators, right? Kill and consume more than one victim to complete develop. They can eat larva, or they can eat adult. So that's what the predators are, potential biocontrol agent. So nowadays you can see, for earlier we can find it, there is a bird, right? So blackish with the brownish with I don't know about in singular and other English, for in Tamil name we call it sambaka. So it will everywhere in every home you can find it, that sambaka. Now it is extinct. Why? Because of our mismanagement practices. It was a very good predator. Any caterpillars it can pick and eat. In the paddy field, you can go and see lot of these cranes, lot of mynas, a lot of peacocks. What they are doing? They are predations. They are pest. If you are spraying chemicals, their population is gone. Broad spectrum, right? This is we called as a natural predators. So we are going to discuss some insect predator. What are the insect predators? You can use it easily. So this is predator. So if you want to select the predator, you have to know what are the effective biological control characters. What are the characters of effective biocontrol? High complete prey specificity. High complete prey specificity mean, so you have predator should be an host specific. If the predator, host specific predators are very limited, right? Host specific predators are very limited, but some you can narrow down, Lepidopteran predator, Coleopteran predator like that. So if it is a complete prey, means completely very efficient eating, then it is good. And multivoltine with respect to the target species mean, so according to the population increases, this population also should increase and finish that pest. Well adapted to habitat to the target species. Where that pest there, it should also live, adapt to live on that place. That is, we call it as a well adapted. Excellent searching ability. Does mean very good eyes and sensing. where are that prey is there, and go and immediately pick. In these qualities is there, then it's a good predator. Anyone good parasitoids too. So one such example, this is a lacewing bugs. You see the lacewing bugs, it's a larva, right? Neuroptera, lacewing bugs belongs to mayflies. Lacewing bugs we call as an for neuropterans. So this neuropterans, because they are eating lacewing, right? Immature, so they are targeting on the caterpillar. So the mode of predators, what are the mode they are using, tactic use they are used by the predators? One is active search, fly and search and eat. Other one is ambush. Predator will be there as it is if the prey is going trapping. For example, spider, it will make some webs, it will be there as without any movement, it will be like that. If it is preying, is going, it will be automatically trapped into the webs. Then what will do the spider? It will go, just inject a venom, it will come back. So finally the prey move vigorously and finally it will die and take it. That is we call it as a traps. Ambush mean it will be there where the pathogen is moving like that, or some pest is moving like that, sudden attack. The climber attacks or vehicle, moving vehicles attacked by bombs, no? Like the ambush technique. So this is used by the some entomopathogenic nematode, the antlion larva. In backside home, if you are going there, in the ground, there are some insect will be there with a little bit of cavity, no? It will be like this ambush. If this any insect is moving like that one, antlion larva immediately trap it and pull it inside their traps. And this is we call as an ambush, trap with an ambush. Another one is the lure. Some predators, what they will do, no, they will spray some scent. This scent mimic pheromone of these females, of this pest. What they will do? So immediately these pests will come. So then they will trap it. That is we call as a lure. So it is just creating an interest to the pest, and when the pest is weak, it will eat it. So these are the mode of predation of biocontrol agents. We will study one by one, but other examples. Initial introduction, the first time the Chinese scientists, they discovered that Asian waver rat for the biological control. These are the social insect, very group of very aggressive, voracious insect. So they will, what they will do is they will colonize in their field. They bring it, this ant the colony, and colonize it somewhere else where they want to manage the pest in their paddy field. It will kill all the pests for the food, right? So it's an earliest known one, but nowadays they are not using because they are very dangerous. And bugs, this is we called as a pirate bugs. You see, bugs, they are eating on this. What is this? This insect in the bottom. This is we called as an sting bugs. So green sting bug, brown sting bug. So this is a predator, just eating, right? Eating. This is a lacewing bugs. I told you the first, this is a lacewing bugs, the neuropterin, right? This is an adult, this is an egg. You see how they are protecting their eggs. Laying eggs in the top of the needle like yes, right? So this is an grub eating all these white flies and aphids. Right, white flies and green lacewing bugs. So this is green leaf bugs. They are trapping and eating. It's an adder. Then ladybird beetle, any very good predators. Everywhere you can see nowadays population also declining because of this over-application of this. This is an polyphagous predator. It's a polyphagous predator. So it can eat all these mealybugs, aphids, and other small pests, everything it can eat. Right? It's a very active one. Right? Very active one. You can easily mass multiply and release it. This is a grub of a ladybird beetle. Right? Ladybird beetle. This is the shape and the color. Right? This is a grub and how it is working. Another one is the roof beetle. these roof beetles also will be there, but this population and identification and this existence in Sri Lanka is very less. But if in the, this is most commonly available in the US, Americans, North American and South American. The ground beetle, this is also a very good predator. It will be always there in the ground. This is a farmer friend because it is creating aeration to the farmers and mixing this nutrition to the soil adverse, and also they are eating all the non-mobile pupation in the pupas and other insect living root grubs. They are in the ground. Nowadays, this population also less because of this soil fumigants and other chemicals sprayed. Especially the one such nasty chemical is Furuda. Now it's banned. It killed many beneficial soil, beneficial beetles. Another one is the praying mantids. It's a very good predator, right? It's a very good predator. Praying mantids also, it is, you can see everywhere. No need to much worry about that one. If you are giving the condition, automatically it will multiply. But through the chemicals, we are killing these natural benefits. So it can eat all the moths and caterpillars and everything. So minute pirate bugs. These are very small bugs. If they are in small larva, it will be eaten. So, but the problem is, these bugs, if it is available, farmers, they cannot distinguish with pest and the predator. What they will do, they will think this is these are also pests. Then spray. That's the thing, we have to enlighten the farmers. Enlighten the farmers to differentiate which is beneficial, which is harmful. Thereafter, they should take the decision. If they are finding any insect, they are applying chemicals. It's what is creating that problem. Then another one is a big-eyed bug. Right? This big-eyed bug also eating the white flies. Right? White flies and the leafhoppers, eggs, and everything it is eating. Sting bugs, we have already discussed. So, right, sting bug is eating and different type of insect, and the this is also the sting bug, pirate bug. Right, and robber flies. So robber flies also very good predator. It was abundant maybe in 5 to 10 years ago, even in Sri Lanka and everywhere in the farmer field. But nowadays its population also declined because the farmers confused. This is also a pest. Because it looks like bees and house flies, right? And fruit flies. So that's how the farmers sprayed many unwanted chemicals they have abolished. Sprayed fly adults, right? So if it, this is also a dipteran, so it's a dipteran, right? Sprayed fly. This is always there in the flowers. When the pest is coming to take in moths, and other beetles are coming to get the pollen, it will catch it. And striped larva, you see, striped larva is eating the aphids. Then another, other than this insect, you can see the predatory mites. Some of the predatory mites are there. These are transparent ones, so they can eat other mites. That's what we call as a predatory mites. So mites also you can use as a predator. And spiders, many very good spiders, it was there. If you are going there in the peripheral fields in the early morning, if you are cultivating organically. Nowadays, the spider population also we have declined. So due to this over-application of these nasty insecticides and the fungicides. So these are also very good predators. Whatever the moths, especially moths, and in the nights, the, some of these moths will come to lay eggs. The spiders can, right? So spin these webs and nicely, and it can automatically trap these adults and it can control. But our farmers, their foolishness, so we have lost this biodiversity. So these predatory insects, right? These predatory insects, you can see predatory insect, you can see the belongs to different orders, right? So different orders, Coleoptera, Diptera, Hemiptera, and Neuroptera. And some of these Thysanoptera also, you can find thrips also, the thrips family, some predatory thrips are there. mainly the Coleoptera, Diptera, Hemiptera, Neuroptera. So are predatory insect. Majority of them are predatory insect. Other than that, you can also find Neuroptera, Odonata, dragonflies, and pine mantids. Also, you can find it. They are also predators. Some nematodes and mites also act as a predators. For example, entomopathogenic nematode. There are two families, Heteroraptides and Steinonyma, right? Heteroraptides and Steinonyma, these are entomopathogenic nematodes. Mainly we are using to manage all these insects, all these pests. Entomopathogenic nematodes, so they can eat only the insects. That's so for young ones, we are using that nematodes. And arachnids, some of these spiders, these are the spiders mentioned as the predators. Other than that insect predators, we can see the vertebrates also available, right? Several vertebrates are also available. So these vertebrates also can manage your pest nicely, right? Aramidolos, you see that it's an anteaters, right? Anteaters, then punctum, pancolin. So nowadays we are searching that, so bat eaters transmitted that COVID-19, so pancolin is a very good predators, right? Very good predators. So some of these fishes, in the rice field, right? Fish duck rice integration. You would have studied in animal science, right? Nowadays, what they are doing is they are releasing the fishes into the paddy field, because the water will be there. These fishes can eat whatever the insect, especially the brown plant hoppers, they will prefer to live in the water air interface, no? So they can easily manage it, right? Fishes. So earlier you would have seen that it's a lot of sparrows. Nowadays it's very difficult to find that, right? Snakes, many snakes. It was, if you are starting the paddy cultivation, you can see the snakes. Why snakes are coming over there? Right? Why snakes are coming over there? Right? To eat whatever the insects are there. Earlier you can see frogs will be there. Right? Frogs. Farmers will think that, so snakes are coming to catch the frogs. But frogs are also predators. Snakes are also predators. And farmers, finally, if you are finding them, but that's what many farmers, they have attacked by these snakes too, right? They have attacked. That's how they are killing, right? Killing the snakes. For the racons, some of these birds, right? For the lizards, right? Lizards also act as these vertebrates, right? For the scorpions, you see, these scorpions can eating these grasshoppers very nicely. And millipedes, centipedes, they are also act as a predator. What the people nowadays, we are killing these scorpions, we are finding anywhere. So they are thinking that it's dangerous to them. Spiders, people are killing because they are thinking that it's dangerous. Snakes, people are killing because they are thinking they're dangerous. Right? So dangerous. Spiders, how they are eating, right? In the moths. Another group is their parasitoids. Parasitoids are the group of organisms, right? Parasitoids are the group of organism, mainly belongs to two order. One is order Hymenoptera, other one is order Diptera, right? So instead of predators, parasitoids, they will not prey the insect. What they will do is they will lay the eggs inside the pest body or over the pest body. So due to that, the emerging immature stages of the parasitoids will eat that insect. That's the way the parasitoids works. Right? Predators, they will catch and eat, but parasitoid, what they will do? Just lay the egg above the body or over the body of the insect stages. All stages can eat. So according to the where they are laying eggs or eating the body parts or surviving, you can divide this one as a endoparasitoids and ectoparasitoids. Endoparasitoids mean they will emerge inside the insect body and eat in the inner content of the insects. Ectoparasitoid mean, so The parasitoid lay the egg outside the body, emerging larva eaten from the outside. Right? That is what we call it, ectoparasitoids. Egg laid outside, egg laid inside, endo, right? So endoparasitoids develop inside the host, associated with the host in both concealed and exposed sites, right? Exposed sites or concealed sites. Endoparasites develop outside the host, so typically associated with the protected sites, tunnels, leaf miners, mines, and road larvas, everywhere you can find. So these are some of these wasps. I said these are some of the wasps. How they are targeting, right? So this wasp we call it as an adult parasitoids. So you can classify in which stage it's targeted into three different: egg parasitoids, larval parasitoids, pupal parasitoids, adult parasitoids, right? Egg parasitoid, larval, pupal, adult parasitoids. Adult parasitoids are rare. Egg parasitoids and larval parasitoids are abundant. Pupate parasitoids also you can expect somewhat extra, right? So very good egg parasitoids are Trichogramma, right? So Trichogramma, mainly what they are doing is they are laying eggs in the eggs of the pest. That is what we call it as an egg parasitoids. They lay eggs inside the eggs of the pest. That's how before emergence of the larva, parasitoid of the pest population will be declined. That's how the selection of egg parasitoid, isolation and identification of the egg parasitoids are very cost effective and very highly appreciated and very effective. Larval parasitoids, what they will do, they lay the eggs inside the larva, over the larva, then larva will be killed by the young ones of the parasitoids. Pupal parasitoids mean, I don't lay egg very closer to the pupa because penetration of the pupal gas is very difficult. But they will do over the body of the pupa. Mainly they are laying eggs, immatures, emergence, they can eat because they have the very good mandible, no? Very good mandible and eat. So here you can see some of these aphids, right? You can see some of these aphids with mummified aphids, you see? So this is a very big stomach-like abdomen, no? Why? Because it's egg laid by the parasitoid. So young ones, they are eating the inside kernel. That's what is a very big wire, stomach like this. This one, see, so parasitoid adult cut the body surfaces and released inside here. So adult emerged. Adult parasitoid emerged from the aphid body. This is we call it as a mummified aphids. Right, what's it called? Mummified aphids. Aphid will be like a mummy. Inside that body, right? Body, it's called mummified aphid. You see how small these parasitoid lay the eggs, right? Lay the eggs. So these are some of these examples. Polyembryonic has taken place in the bila. Polyembryonic also you can find this. So parasitoid sometimes you can see its behavior is maybe solitary, sometimes polyembryonic. Sometimes sometimes some parasitoid lay one egg per host. From the one egg, one adult or one larva of the parasitoid will emerge. We call it as a single parasitoid, solitary. Some of these we call it polyembryonic. So parasitoid lay one egg. From that one egg of the parasitoids, many larva of the parasitoids will come out because of polyembryonic, like mango. From the one seed, you will see many seedlings, right? That we call it as a polyembryonic. This is one of such example, polyembryonic. Other one is in polyprogeny. Polyprogeny means one parasitoid lay multiple egg in one host. From the multiple over each and every X, number of larvas will emerge. That's the thing, right? There are three different categories. This is the polyembryonic character, right? So here, so you can see polyembryonic mean lay egg. You can see the full of parasitoid what is full of parasitoid larva, right? So you see, full of parasitoid larva, this body fully parasitoid larva, is a polyembryonic one. He, I saw, this is ectoparasitic one. So caterpillars, the parasitoid lay egg outside. From this parasitoid, you see how these macaws emerge. They are going to penetrate and eating. This one, so this is we call it a long-legged fly, right? But they captured it. They are going to lay eggs, right? These are the mummified. That's what I told you. Mummified. You see, from the cartilage, adult will emerge, right? You see, wasp laid egg. These are the eggs. So this is the eggs. From these eggs, pupa have developed. Yeah, when you are rearing that insect, you will feel, you will experience these things, right? You will think that your larva have pupated, but is actually this is a parasitoid pupa, right? So this is the wasp ejecting the eggs. You see bottom, from the bottom, they are ejecting the eggs into the aphid body. How? Right? So the parasitoid wasp belongs to Hymenoptera. In the Hymenoptera, there are different families. Ephelinidae, Braconidae, Ecrypteridae, Eulophidae, and Pteromelidae, and Trichogrammatidae. These Trichogrammatidae and Braconidae, right? So Braconidae and Trichogrammatidae, they are very good parasitoids. These are Trichogramma is a very good egg parasitoids. Braconidae is a very good larval parasitoids, right? Many larval parasitoids you can expect. This is very a good egg parasitoids. So then the next section is the pathogens. How these pathogens are working to manage the diseases, right? Manage the diseases. So I am going to stop here with, and if you won't ask any question, please you can ask and we will continue in the